Does everyone have their Bibles? I got mine. Can we turn to Hebrews 10:23? I'm reading from NIV. It says, "Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on towards love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching." So as we go into this morning, I just hope that we do that for you this morning. So it's really good to be home. It's been 7 months since I've been home. I think it's almost been a year since Josh has been back. In the last time we were here, we were without Josh because he was actually in Cuba for, I think, 10 days or 2 weeks almost. Rose is only about 7 weeks old. We had a baby shower, which we really appreciated. We didn't expect that, so that was awesome. Yeah, it's really good to be face-to-face because I don't think we haven't shared face-to-face in a really long time. As our church family, your prayers and support have been vital for us this past year. And these are my notes. To start off, we just want to show a quick video of what Josh and I put together, just something that we've been working on since I've had Rhodes. I haven't really been able to do as much as I used to, but we did do this video that we put together. That's something that I can do with Rose, so we'll just watch that quick.
Meet the Island Breeze Manitoba team. We are a group of awesome individuals from all over Canada and the world, and we are proud to be a part of Youth of the Mission. Youth of the Mission, or YWAM, has been around since the 1960s and has missionary bases in over 180 countries around the world, with over 18,000 full-time volunteer missionaries just like us. YWAM's mission is to know God and make Him known. As Island Breeze, we are a YWAM base proud to have a unique flavor. Our mission is to know God and make Him known through God's cultural gifts and expressions within the nations, and that looks like this. We do two very important things. Number one, we use culture to teach others that you should be proud of your identity and embrace all of who God made you to be. Number two, we run an exciting program for people 18 and older called a Discipleship Training School, or a DTS. We call it Prairie to Pacific because we start in the beautiful prairies of Manitoba and then in the tropical paradise of the Pacific. It's also a great way to experience Christ culture and community. During our DTS, we spend 3 months in the classroom learning from a different speaker each week, with topics like how to hear the voice of God and cultural restoration. Then, we take the tools we have learned and travel on outreach for 2 months. This year, we are going to Fiji and Australia to give back to others and make a difference. Our Discipleship Training School is an amazing adventure where you will grow deeper in God and learn more about yourself, all while making a difference in the lives of others. Find out how you can join us for our DTS adventure that begins this August at ywampraytopacific.ca.
So that's what we do 24/7. That's our full-time job. We don't do anything else. this is our life. I started back 7 years ago, 8 years ago. And then Josh was one of the first people to do our DTS, Discipleship Training School. And here we are today, married with one child, which I remember at the wedding. We're like, no kids. Next minute. it's really good to go back to your roots and where you came from. We mentioned Mr. McGee. He was my sixth grade teacher, and he was Pontex's didn't necessarily have a lot of Christian influence there. So when I was there, it was basically me and my class, and Mr. McGee came in and he ended up being Christian. To me, that was such an encouragement to have somebody else there. So Yeah, Jim McGee. I like him. Yeah, it's just really good to go back to your roots. This last year has been one of the more difficult years for us as a ministry and just for us as a married couple. Not that anything's wrong. It's just there's a lot of incidences that have happened this past year that have caused us to rely on people's prayers and support. There was one of our Island Breeze members from overseas. His name was Tuane. He was one of the founders of Island Breeze. So Island Breeze happened in the 60s. He was one of the rocks, one of the people that helped start the program. And they were on tour. There's a group called IWT, Impact World Tour. So they go tour 9 months out of the year, every single country that they've, yeah. So they were in China recently. They were just practicing for an upcoming show, and he actually just collapsed during practice and passed away. That was huge for the community. For Josh and I, like, we only met him in passing. We were in the States somewhere anyways. It was for an Island Breeze gathering, and we only met him in passing, but I ended up watching his funeral online. They do that now, which is cool, so you can be a part of that. And the stories that he had, I watched it to get the stories because I knew how important it was to hear what he had done in his lifetime. And one of the things that he had always said before a show is that we dance for the glory of God, and that's it. We worship him. This is our worship. And even before he passed away, he said, you know, just give glory to God. And that was massive. Being one of the founders, we didn't have the freedom that we do today. One of the stories that they had shared is that, he only had 25 cents in his pocket, and however God led the way, that he could have all this financial support to go and travel the world with 25 cents that he originally had. And another story is that, let me just get it here. Yeah, this whole concept of using culture to worship God in church was just so foreign, even within the churches of Samoa and Fiji. It just wasn't heard of. And they're in a church the one time, and they're going to do a hula worship. And the people came up to them and said, well, actually, we don't really want you to move your hips. We don't think that's a good idea. So they got them to sit on chairs and just do the arm movements instead of fully using their body. We've come such a long way from that point, and we just bless and honor the families of Island Breeze who've led the path for me and Josh, people from Saskatchewan, to be able to worship in this really unique way. Yeah, just to showcase God's beauty through dances. We are able to show hope. One thing that people have told Island Breeze is that our dances will show joy and that they'll show hope for people. And hope has been something that we've had to carry this year. At the funeral, also, that they're saying that Tuane was a mighty tree has fallen. And this year, a number of trees have fallen in our lives. Some only have been just sprouted, a young girl. We are saddened to hear about Victoria and another friend, Jared Robertson, who had passed away. And this summer we had gone to a conference, YWAM conference, and it was during a worship service. A young girl, there was an accident. It was a total accident, and she ended up passing away there, and we saw everything that happened. So that was through the dark. That was, I think, the darkest part for me anyways, in my life, my short life. And I found myself taking steps back from God, just feeling on edge and just waiting for something else to happen, something bad to happen. And but God shows himself through those situations in really bizarre ways. My friend who had passed away, he was in a motorcycle accident. But it was crazy because just a few days before, literally a few days before, he had written a status about this motorcycle ministry that he became a part of. And he was just saying how much it's influenced him in his walk with God. And that to me was amazing because we've gone to Bible camp together and then, you know, he kind of fell away for a bit, and just seeing that he wanted his relationship to grow more with God was huge. And then a few days later he passed away. That to me it's sad, but at the same time it's like, well, no, I have full assurance and hope that I'm going to see him again and we're going to see Victoria again and all that. Like, that's, and the little girl who passed away, she, at the conference, she had saying, like, she can't talk, she's only two. She would say that these people are her people, my people. And that was huge. And I think of this church, and it's small, but we all choose to be here, and we're a community, and we rely on one another. So we went back to the location of where the little girl had passed away as a ministry. It's a conference hall, like, it's, you can go there, and there's rooms, and you can stay the night and stuff. And so we were there for a staff retreat, and it was good to go back. It was a healing thing for us to be able to go back and create new memories there and not just feel hopeless. Not hopeless, but just sad, you know? And, yeah. Also, another thing that helped me get through that was we were in Michigan for 3 weeks. It was a long time, but it was really good. We went to this... we just did like a tour. I don't know if you guys remember, but back maybe 6 years ago, our whole team came here and we did a tour. Anyways, we went to Michigan and did the same thing. And we went to this one place. It's called Little Mary's. And it's this facility where parents and their children can go there for free and have a mini vacation for kids who are terminally ill. So there were no kids or anything, but we just wanted to help clean up the place. They painted the fence. And, you know, I don't know, just a lot of yard work and just fixing the place up. Anyways, we had one night, we wanted to do a show for people in the community. So we ended up doing this song that's called Hope is Alive. And as we were dancing that, like, the family who started that building, they had like 10 kids or something like that. But one of them had died from a brain tumor at a young age. So they wanted a place where parents can go and the kids just to create good memories for them. So they know what loss is like. They know what hurt is like. And having just gotten through what we did with the YMM gathering, it hit home for me being there. And we did Hope is Alive. And to me, that was like something broke for me. So, if you're going through something right now, I'm going to do a dance in a minute. They don't have a boys part, so Josh isn't dancing today. But this song, we learned it in Michigan, and we've been practicing it a lot. We recorded it, like, it was like the day before we left. I was like, I don't want to do this on my own. So I got all the other girls who know the dance I recorded it and they danced it, so it'll be me and the girls dancing for you. So I hope you enjoy. It's called Hope is Alive.
Thank you.
So, as we walk away from today's service, be inspired and motivated to be the hope that many don't have. Isaiah 61 calls us to be oaks of righteousness. So, let your branches reach out to everyone you encounter. Just as the fallen warriors from this past year have done, their legacy lives on. So let your life be the hope people want. In closing, I want to read you the scripture that led me into ministry. And I have to get it here. Isaiah 61, if you have your Bibles. It says, "Let the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives, and release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn and provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. They will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor." I also have one more video that I think I want to show. This is last minute. We have it, though. We have our friend Marissa here, and she's from a reserve, Saigin, and she did her DTS back in 2013, and just as fruits of her labor, she and Josh too, like, they did our discipleship training school. We want to get into the places where there doesn't seem to be a lot of hope, and there seems to be a lot of hurt just a lot of hurt. Not all the reserve is like that, but we just created a really good relationship with them, and we've had a number of students that come from Saigin, so we just want to show you what we have been able to do. So, yes.
I love through the work that they do, and when I first watched them, when they first... They share their love through the work that they do, and when I first watched them, when they first did their dances, I could see the love in their faces. And you know, even people that saw them for the first time, they said to me after they danced, they just felt like crying, because you could see the love in their faces and their eyes, and you know, in their dances. It's very powerful. Yeah, it's just amazing. Imagine our people, you know, myself and my family, being like that, you know, dancing and just sharing the love of God in our dance and our songs.
Like the people of Saigin, we have seen God connect our music and dance to bring about restoration of Canada's Indigenous people. Their greatest desire is to see their youth know Jesus, to be healed and set free from alcohol and drug addictions. Through our ministry, God has opened the doors to have four young people from Saigin First Nations go through our DTS program over the last 5 years, furthering the circle of hope in that community.
My grandson also was with the DTS program, and he's gone to Fiji right now. Yeah, and he's changed. Well, we're just praising the Lord that the change that's in him, and we've seen the change in him. And he's posting a lot of pictures from TG, and it's just a big smile and happy, just being himself.
As Christians, we were taught not to go there, you know, not to get involved in our culture. And that's a sad part. It's really sad when, you know, and yet God wants us to be who we are as Aboriginal people, as Indigenous people, and not to be ashamed, because that's what I learned as a child, to be ashamed of my culture and who I am. And it's, you know, for us coming to Jesus, for me coming to Jesus, it's been quite a healing journey.
After getting the call to return to the Pacific, our DTS has created an opportunity to experience the glory of God working through our young people firsthand. The joy and delight to be on the other side of the world is furthering the redemptive work in our students' hearts, which in turn will be brought back home with them.
One of the things that he told me when he's out in Fiji is that we're not going into the touristy places, we're going to the real thing, he says, you know, in the culture. Yeah, but where the natives of the land there, eh? And that meant a lot to him. So when he comes back, and then he'll appreciate our culture and our elders and the things that we do. And that's what I mean, it brings it back, and it connects them, yeah, to who we are.
So now my grandson is in there, and oh my goodness, I'm just so blessed. He's gone to Fiji. I'm just so blessed. I can't thank God enough for that. I really can't thank Jesus enough for that. For that blessing, you know, and I'm gonna cry.